Microsoft recently announced a new chip designed for quantum computing, claiming significant progress toward creating a topological qubit. This has generated a lot of excitement as topological qubits are theorized to be more resilient to noise, a major hurdle in building a practical quantum computer. However, the announcement has also been met with skepticism. Microsoft has been working on topological qubits for a long time, and this isn't their first time and first bold claim about topological qubits. Back in 2017, they have made a similar announcement that ultimately didn't lead to a breakthrough that they have initially hoped for about topological qubits. So, hi everyone, and welcome back to OpenLab. This is Taha Saleem, and today we are gonna dive deep into the exciting world of topological quantum computing and discussing the recent buzz surrounding Microsoft's claim of a historical progress in topological qubits and realizing
Majorana
qubits. So, what exactly has Microsoft achieved this time? The details are still a bit unclear, so we have many questions about this. Like, what are topological qubits? What is so significant about topological qubits instead of other conventional qubits? Satya Nadella, also the Microsoft CEO, showed the chip design at a recent video and a recent podcast, but the specs are still under wraps, still unclear. Like, for example, how many qubits does this chip support? What are the error rates, fidelity, coherence time, and the gate time? What are the connectivity and the architecture of the chip? And a side note, this is also not Microsoft's only work about topological qubits. Quantinuum had also some work about topological qubits, which formerly known as Cambridge Quantum Computing, now merged with Honeywell and became Quantinuum. They have also announced progress in creating and manipulating non-abelian anions, the building blocks of topological qubits, using their H2 trapped ion processor. So before we analyze these claims, let's discuss why topological qubits first are so important and why they could be a game changer for quantum computing and how they differ from traditional qubits. In brief, the biggest obstacle in building a practical quantum computer is noise. Traditional qubits are extremely sensitive to environmental noise, which causes them to lose their quantum state and the information they store, a process known as the decoherence. But to combat this, researchers have developed quantum error correction codes. However, these codes add significant overhead and are still not enough to achieve fully fault-tolerant quantum computers. This is where topological qubits come in. They offer the potential for intrinsically noise-resistant qubits encoding information in a way that's inherently protected from local disturbances. The idea of topological protection is to encode quantum information in a global property of the system that remains unchanged even when the system is deformed. The idea is similar to what we do in a surface codes, but with a twist. The protection comes from the topology of the system itself. One way to achieve this is by using the Aharonov boom effect, where an electron is transported around magnetic solenoid, acquires a phase shift that depends on the topology of its path. With this, you can realize a fault-tolerant topological quantum computer. In 1997, Alexei Kitaev, if I pronounce the name correctly, proposed a model for topological quantum computations using anions, exotic particles with fractional statistics that emerge in certain topological states of matter. Let's zoom in on this detail a bit. In principle, you can perform classical computing fault tolerantly. However, we don't use this since classical bits and the classical gates are reliable. So this is a significant difference between classical and quantum computers. Take, for example, all the storage media and think about how we store classical informations on them. Classical informations are stored with the aid of magnetic fields on this media, and there is magnetic fields arise from the spins of individual atoms, and each spin is sensitive to the environment. So in principle, it can flip. However, if such error happens, the collective interaction coming from other spins will force this flipped spin to back to its original state. So there is some sort of self-correction, or the information is actually stored in a much bigger picture. So this is again similar to the standard error correction with repetition codes, like in communications and other applications as well. Hence, if the same approach is applied to qubits, This would mean that you need a class of stabilizer quantum codes associated with lattices, for example, on a torus or a 2D surfaces, and then you can represent your system as a Hamiltonian with the ground state protected in that code. And the excitant states or the excitations can be treated as quasi-particles, where we can call them anions. So this is a powerful one. So you can encode quantum information in quantum numbers or in quantum excitations that happen in this particular global structure or 2D code. So you have the ground state and then the excitations will just, you can use them to store quantum informations in them. These anions also can be braided and diffused to perform quantum computations with information encoded in their non-local properties. And if you can keep these quasi-particles set apart from one another, you can have a built-in immunity or resilience against noise. So now we know why they are called anions. Now let's come to the non-abelian. When we need to perform a quantum gate, we need to be able to apply a sequence of complex unitary operations on the qubits. This is where the non-abelian anions come in. They have the unique property that the order in which they are exchanged matters, allowing for the implementation of such quantum gates. So such non-abelian anions can arise in specific systems like fractional quantum Hall states and the topological superconductors. One of the most promising candidates for creating topological qubits are
Majorana
zero states, or they are abbreviated as MZMs. These are quasi-particles with unique properties. They are non-abelian, so they follow non-abelian statistics, where the order in which they are exchanged matters. Also, they are zero-energy modes. They have zero excitation energy. This makes them robust against low-energy disturbances, enhancing their stability. And they have topological protections, where MZMs are localized at topological defects in certain materials, such as the ends of topological superconductors. This topological protection shields them from local noise and perturbations, making them less prone to decoherence. And now we come to, more importantly, they have fermion parity. The fermion parity, whether the number of fermions is even or odd, of a pair of
Majorana
zero modes is a topologically invariant, meaning that it is robust against local perturbations as well. This property can be used to encode a qubit. And finally, they have braiding and diffusion properties, where MZMs can be braided or exchanged and diffused, brought together to perform quantum operations. The outcome of fusion measurements reveals the computational result. And consequently, with all of these properties, they can operate at higher temperatures, so they don't require cryogenic nature or sub-millikelvin to live in. While the concept of topological qubits is exciting, experimental realization is challenging. Recent advances, however, have been promising. Like, for example, Microsoft's One chip demonstrates the measurement of fermion parity, a key step towards topological quantum computations. This has been done in the implementation of a single-shot interferometric measurement of fermion parity in a gate-defined superconducting nanowire made of indium, arsenide, aluminium, heterostructures. And as I have said earlier, Quantinuum has achieved also the creation and the manipulation of non-abelian anions in their trapped ion processor H2. So these are just steps or milestones out of many steps that are required for experimental reliable realization of topological qubits. In that sense, we can look with fresh eye on Microsoft's announcement. While demonstrating fermion parity measurement is significant, it is just one step in a long road towards fully realized topological qubits. So this is not translated automatically to a fully working topological qubit yet. So questions like how many qubits can be encoded, how to perform error correction, and how to perform universal quantum computations are still open. The quest for topological qubits is a fascinating journey, while its challenges remain. Recent progress proposes that we are moving closer to realizing their potential. If successful, this could revolutionize quantum computing and pave the way for fault-tolerant quantum computers capable of solving some of the world's most challenging problems. Thanks for watching. Don't forget to like, subscribe, and hit the notification bell for more exciting updates from the world of quantum computing. This is Taha Saleem, and this is Open Lab, and until then, see you next time.